play it forward. Go ahead, guys.
Play it forward on WUSB Stony Brook 90.1 and 107.3 FM. Happy Friday, everyone. And happy holidays, everyone. So alongside of me are my co-hosts and fellow advocates of Play It Forward, Kurt Hall and Taylor Solomon. Momentarily, we will introduce our guest, New York DEA Special Agent in Charge, Frank Tarentino. Before we begin, I'd like to pass the mic to Taylor.
Hello, everyone. Thank you for tuning in. The Play It Forward Project is a nonprofit with a mission to bring awareness, education, and advocacy to the fentanyl opioid crisis. The Play It Forward show is a podcast for riveting conversations about illicit drugs, fentanyl, and substance use disorder. This platform allows us to bring in the wise, the dedicated, game changers, and civilians' voices. We broadcast from Stony Brook University's radio station live every other Friday, 1 to 2 Eastern Standard Time. Close to 2 p.m., we shout out a treasure trove of resources that are welcoming and accessible. There is help, counseling, guidance, treatment, and community.
We are on Instagram at sbu.playitforward. Check that out. On YouTube at the Play It Forward Project, all one word, is where you can listen to our previous show on the go. If you connect with the mission, we truly appreciate your support on social media. That way, our mission can reach more people. You can also reach us by email at sbu.tpifp@gmail.com. We'd love to hear from you.
Yep, and I have great news that the organization will become a club on Stony Brook University's campus.
Woo-hoo! Yes,
yeah, Taylor.
So we are excited to continue and expand the advocacy, and we need more student club members. Presenting next is Kurt, who will share a few facts about fentanyl.
Fentanyl is a highly potent synthetic opioid that is 30 to 50 times stronger than heroin. As little as 2 milligrams of fentanyl have been killing many people every day. Here's a visual picture of Penny. The amount that is on Abraham Lincoln's nose is a fatal dose. This deadly opioid kills one person on average every 11 minutes, making it the leading cause of death for adults ages 18 to 45. That means approximately 5 people will die during our show. Fentanyl's devastating toll claims over 200 lives each day. This is similar to a commercial plane crashing every single day. Without further ado, here is Allison to introduce our guests.
Thank you, Kurt and Taylor. It's Friday before Christmas. We are deep dive into the holiday season. For all its presumed joy, the holidays can be hard for families dealing with drug addiction or who've lost loved ones to overdose. It's often a hard time for people who are using, people who are celebrating, and normal routines are disrupted. Not a good combo for people trying to stay sober. For all of you out there dealing with these tough issues, you have our support and we wish you strength. Our guest today is DEA Special Agent in Charge, Frank Tarentino. Over the course of his 25-year career with the Drug Enforcement Agency, Frank's done everything from international drug smuggling to organized crime closer to home. He started his career with the DEA in New York, then Afghanistan, New Jersey, and then was promoted to Special Agent in Charge of the Seattle Division, and last year became the lead agent in charge of New York State, the largest division of the DEA. Frank has been on the front lines trying to keep fentanyl and other drugs out of supply chains. He is also very involved and hands-on with the community, and he truly cares about this problem. Frank was one of the hosts and keynote speakers at the DEA's second national family summit on fentanyl poisoning epidemic back in November, which I attended. I learned so much from him that day and from our last show back in April, so I wanted to have him back on today. So on behalf of Play It Forward and WUSB, I'd like to warmly welcome New York DEA Special Agent in Charge, Frank Tarentino. Frank, welcome to Play It Forward. We are so grateful for you to be here today, and thank you for your service to our country.
Well, Allison, Kurt, and Taylor, thank you for having me back on the Play It Forward show. It's great to be here, and I look forward to our conversation today.
Thank you so much. We have a lot of questions for you, so here's Kurt to get it rolling.
To set the tone, we were wondering if you could maybe share some insights into the current landscape of fentanyl-related incidents during the holiday season.
Kurt, this is a really important time of year. First and foremost, this is a great opportunity for families to reconnect. This is a great opportunity for families to enjoy each other's company and to celebrate successes and emphasize some of the more important values and traditions that families are built and strengthened by. And I think in this current climate of the synthetic opioid crisis that we face, this is a really great opportunity to have those very difficult conversations with our loved ones about the dangers that lurk on social media, that lurk out in the streets in which we live, in the communities in which we work. And I think this is oftentimes overlooked because we get caught up in the daily lives and the busyness that comes with that. And I think this is just a really nice time of year to show how much we care and how much we love each other by having those difficult conversations.
Yeah, absolutely. And I want to kind of touch on that a little bit, because as this is a joyful time and can be a really happy time, it can also be a really difficult time for people. And that goes, I think, across the board, whether it's loved ones that have lost somebody. The holidays are a tough time to get through. I was just with somebody who attended your summit, Mary Ellen, last night, who lost her son, my really good friend, 2 years ago. You know, and we were talking about that, and the holidays have been really tough thinking about him. Yeah. And I also can tie into some of my own story of being absent during holidays, not being invited to holidays, not being welcome at holidays, being in treatment during holidays. And there's a lot of triggers. Going home to family can be a great thing, and you can see everybody and you can have a really loving, great time, but you maybe don't have a great relationship with your family, and you're going home to an environment that you used to use in that is triggering to you now. And maybe you don't have the coping skills that you necessarily thought you had, and I think it can really sneak up on people. So I just wanted to kind of touch on that a little bit, and the importance of reaching out to those that may be struggling during this time. You know, one thing for me was just having people reach out and let me know that they were there, that they still cared. If you have a loved one that's out there using, you know, see if they need anything, if they need blankets, clothes, if they need a place to stay temporarily, something like that.
Reach out.
Yeah, because it's really hard for us in addiction to, you know, we have a lot of guilt that comes up from being absent and from ruining holidays and whatnot. So it's a really tough time of year for everybody. Yeah, very triggering. But I think it can also be a really joyous time. So I think we have both sides of that.
Yeah, so be there for people, because everybody is important.
Mm-hmm.
I think it's important that our listeners know you guys do way more than just lock up the bad guys.
Yeah.
Your outreach efforts are so commendable. So why don't you speak about what our listeners need to know more about what you do?
Well, thank you, Allison. I think, Kurt, you know, your message is really important, and I appreciate you sharing that, because it's something that affects all of us. And this is the unfortunate situation we find ourselves in today, that this affects all Americans. Mm-hmm. There is someone in our life once or twice or three times removed who has been impacted by this opioid crisis that we face. I mean, we're talking about numbers that we've never seen before. So 110,757 Americans died in 2023, where if we're looking at a time frame of May to May of 2021 to 2023, we're talking about 112,000 Americans that have died to overdoses and poisonings in the United States. And so this number should shock the conscience. This number should mean something to each and every one of us. When we talk about just how devastating this is, we're talking about the leading cause of death between Americans 18 to 45.
Right.
That's crazy.
Right? And so what we can't forget is that this isn't a silent killer that, you know, just sneaks up. There are a lot of signs and warnings that we should pay attention to, and this is the part of the conversation that is difficult. And this is why we have to educate the public, and this is why each American needs to take the time to go to our website, read our material, educate yourself, and then share that with as many people as you can. Because the information is there. The data is there. We have done an incredible job of crunching that data. The last time we were together,
back in April,
we were advertising to the world that there was 6 out of every 10 pills that we tested were lethal.
Mm-hmm.
So a year later, I can sit here and tell you that 7 out of the 10 pills that we test are lethal.
We had to change all our we had to change it from 6 to 7. Yeah.
And I think, you know, kind of to tie in all this too, you know, we've spoken before about how it's almost like people are talked out, you know, and we talk a lot, you know. And I think to Allison's point about you guys doing so much, you know, you're out there, and I can't tell you how many people I've met on this journey that had went to that summit and what a profound impact that had on them, you know, family members that have lost loved ones, you know, still talking about it today and how meaningful it was for them to be heard, you know, and I think that that speaks so much to what you guys are doing.
Yeah, Kurt, what I would say, you know, and Allison mentioned it, we do tremendous work and our cases really do speak for themselves. Mm-hmm. And I could sit here for hours and tell you the incredible work that we've done, the impactful cases that are now going before judges in the Southern and Eastern District of New York and the Western and Northern Districts of New York. That is something that we do extremely well. But that's not the most important thing when we talk about saving lives. Saving lives is also about educating the public and making sure that we give the American people the information they need to make good choices. And it's also about making sure that educators, caregivers, and parents have enough of a framework of what is causing the most harm in their community so that they can have those conversations with their loved ones. So we have done an incredible job, I believe, not just here in New York, but across the country as an agency, going out and spreading our message. And we put out a number of public safety announcements, alerts. We've provided on our DEA.gov site, DEA.gov/onepill. You can go there. You can download all the material. You can use the material in the classroom. You can use it in the community. We have no problem whatsoever that you take that and you make it your own.
We're not going to get sued for copyright?
Not at all. Not at all. We want people to use it.
Of course, yeah.
Yeah, there's a wealth of information. I've been many times to your site.
Yes, yes. And I think to Kurt's point about the impact, it has a reciprocal effect, right? The agents, the investigators, the men and women who do the work every day on the front lines are rejuvenated and re-energized by hearing the stories, the messages from these parents, these loved ones that have been taken from us too soon. And that is the purpose. That is the underlining mission in what we do, and that's saving lives. And so, you know, we gain just as much from them as I hope they gain from us in these conversations. And these are conversations that will go on for a very long time.
Yeah. Yeah. And I think that the saving lives is kind of twofold, because you're preventing the death of others, you know, but you're also giving hope to people who have lost loved ones. Yeah. And I think that in that dark, dark time, your presence, your willingness to listen, your commitment to being with them, I really think is like a very twofold thing. And I think that you're really giving them some hope and essentially saving them. You know, it's catastrophic when you lose somebody. And sometimes it's really hard to go on.
Your own child. I left that summit with hope, and I could say that the parents and the people that were there felt the same way. I want to thank you for that.
Well, you know, Allison, I say something all the time that I think is indicative of the men and women that we have in our division, and that is the men and women of the New York division are dealers in hope. And the work that they do is exactly that. It provides hope and optimism to the communities in which we serve and protect. It shows the American people that we do care. It shows the American people that we're willing to put ourselves in harm's way to stop this poison from flowing into the United States, and that we genuinely care about their health and welfare. And, you know, this is something that it's a lifelong mission to do good. And I think when we talk about this work, we sometimes forget about that these men and women come from so many different places, but in the end of the day, they all serve for one purpose, and that is to save lives.
Wow.
Beautiful. Yeah.
Commend you for your service. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
What are we jumping into next?
I want to touch upon social media.
Okay.
How has the landscape of drug sales, especially fentanyl-laced pills, evolved on social media platforms over the past few years?
So, Allison, we have to go back to what was most prominently found on the streets, and that is the plant-based drugs. And, and plant-based drugs still do exist in large quantities, but the new landscape is the synthetic opioids. And the reason for that is it's just more efficient, more effective, and it's cheaper.
As a marketing standpoint from the dealer's perspective. Yeah.
Yes. I mean, but even from a manufacturing, cultivation, and transportation production model, from a business model, it's more efficient. They don't have to wait for a growing season. They don't have to wait for any cultivation. They don't have to wait for, you know, any resource, natural resources to be in abundance. This is a synthetic-made drug in rudimentary labs in Mexico that is being transported into the United States in so many different ways, by land, sea, air, by water. This is something that we have to understand is in large abundance quantities that we've never seen before. So it is in greater quantities, it is in greater lethality, and it is more easily and widely available to the American public. And part of that is because of social media. So social media has been weaponized by the cartels. They've taken and harnessed that capability to reach a greater audience. And when we talk about the multiple millions of social media users that the United States has, we're talking about an incredible network of potential clients that the cartels can advertise to. And don't mistake this for just a, you know, target of opportunity. This is very deliberate in their approach to how they spread their business across the United States, but also from a global point of view. So what we say, very simply, is that if you have a phone in your pocket, you have a drug dealer in your pocket.
Well, parents, caregivers, you need to listen to that. What about emojis? Let's touch upon that, because a lot of parents, well, I mean, kids being off of school during the holidays, they're going to be spending a lot more time on social media.
Unsupervised, maybe.
Yeah.
Home alone.
And I think it's really important that parents have this information. So what advice would you give to parents and caregivers for the holiday season, or any other time for that matter, regarding social media?
Yeah, what should they be looking out for?
So listen, I have three children. I have a teenager still in the house that is a habitual social media user. And, you know, it is definitely a new tool that our young people utilize on a regular basis. I would just say that parents need to be more curious about the conversations that they're having and whom they're having them with, and in the manner in which they're having those conversations. And so the coded language that the cartels and the drug traffickers are using is intentional to hide and disguise what they're advertising. But the general public, the people that are seeking this, have an understanding of what that coded language is. Parents may not. But when parents see strings of emojis that are confusing, they should ask questions. Mm. They should be curious about what this actually means. And so this is the time when parents and children might struggle in having those conversations. But at the end of the day, what I would tell parents is invading your child's privacy, although uncomfortable, may save their life.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right. And that's, you know, unfortunately, I think a lot of parents fall guilty or fall into that trap of not my kid, you know, and I don't mean to say it bluntly, but what conversation is worse to have?
That's right.
Before or after, you know?
Yeah. I mean, it's a necessary conversation.
Yeah.
And I think parents will be surprised at their kids' reaction. I think kids may be uncomfortable and they may not like it, but I really truly believe deep down they feel more loved, and they feel like, hey, they're looking out for me, but they're going to show expression of being annoyed at that time.
Well, the bottom line is that chances are, if they're using something, they're in pain, they're trying to escape, they're hurting, they're scared, they're lost, they're whatever. And, you know, maybe that conversation is going to open a door to a whole a whole new relationship with them, you know, and maybe this is what they're looking for. And, you know, I've had my son on before. We've talked about him multiple times, and we have a very open relationship about my past and about his current situation and what he's going through. You know, he's a seventh grader in middle school, and what that looks like and what to expect and what kids are doing. And, you know, for a 12-year-old, some of the stuff he tells me is, it's scary, you know? And I have a friend who works here in the Middle Country school system. And
Kids know a lot more nowadays.
Yeah.
They really are more aware because of social media.
Right.
Yeah. Right.
There's a lot of misinformation out there. So I really think it's our job as parents and teachers and mentors to
Humans.
Be vigilant and look over their shoulder. It's okay.
Yeah.
So, you know, I think that it is alarming that 12-year-olds are potentially subjected to this information on social media, but it's true. I can tell you, and Kurt, I appreciate you sharing that story. These kids at younger ages are being exposed to information and to people much earlier than we were when we were kids.
Oh my gosh, it's
because of social media. It's because of the globalization that we face today. And I would even say that the globalization of drug trafficking has changed the landscape. You know, we live in an age now where you can near instantaneously obtain anything that you want or need on
right
social media. And so we're TikTok and Facebook Messenger and Instagram and Snapchat, all of them can do better. All of them should be more responsible about scraping their networks, scraping their platforms to remove the content that is causing the harm. And each of those companies have pledged to do more, but they need to continue to do more.
Right. Right. And keep pledging to continue to do more, so
what
maybe we eventually get there.
Yeah, I mean, that was going to be one of my next questions. It could be changes in their algorithm, right?
Yes.
Are they just reluctant?
Well, I think that these companies are now much more aware of the harm that is on their platforms and on the networks that they, you know, sort of advertise a number of different things on, right? There's a lot of anonymity on these networks that causes problems too. What I would also say is that there are a number of young people, most vulnerable people, that have prescriptions for illicit drugs for various reasons that unfortunately run out of a prescription while they're away at college and don't get a refill, but think that they can borrow it from their friend or they can get it online. And this is where we're seeing these overdoses, these poisonings. And this is why our one pill can kill message is so important, because all it does take is one pill. And so if somebody is taking Adderall and their Adderall prescription runs out and they don't get a refill, they don't get a prescription from a doctor and go to a licensed pharmacist and get an actual prescription filled by a responsible, you know, professional, and they get it online, they're running the risk of overdosing and dying.
Right? It just happened to a friend of mine. He didn't die. Luckily, it was non-fatal. Needed to get more Xanax. And friend said, this is my script. This is my script.
Wow.
This is my script. And yeah, his wife found him unresponsive in the bathroom.
I think it's important for you to mention, because this really stuck out at the summit.
Mm-hmm.
You can't tell the difference. Even your trained chemists that work with you, by even visually looking at it, it's perfectly done.
Yeah. So I want to be clear, too, about this. This is a new... You mentioned the current landscape. I will tell you that almost all drugs today are laced with fentanyl.
Mm.
So we talked about 7 out of 10, but I will tell you that it's not just the pills that are being laced with fentanyl. It's cocaine, it's heroin, it's methamphetamine. It's all types of drugs now have a lethal combination. So I was in our laboratory just the other day in our building in New York City, and I was shocked to find some of the chemists testing different exhibits that had cocaine, methamphetamine, fentanyl, and xylazine. All in the same example.
All in one?
Oh my
all
God.
One.
So now we have this cocktail of lethality that is being produced either in Mexico or it's being adulterated as it moves from Mexico into New York City. And all of these additives is what is causing the harm in New York City.
Wow.
And I think that people need to be mindful that when they're buying something on the street or on social media, it will be laced with fentanyl. It will kill you.
That is what people should be doing, is just automatically assuming that this is
that will kill
unfortunately
you.
In the mind of an addict, it's always never me, you know, and it won't happen to me and it won't happen to me. And really sad. All right, our mid wrap here.
Yeah, we're getting close to a little bit of a mid wrap. And thank you so much for your service, Frank. And everything that you and your department do to keep
us. Do not stop. Yeah. We need you.
Yeah, and we're very excited to bring, I guess I'll just mention before the wrap, we want to have a similar summit here in Suffolk County, here at the university. We're working with the district attorney's office. Shout out to Megan O'Donnell. That was so informative. I feel like I've learned a lot over this past couple of years about this, but I left there with so much more information.
Yeah.
And we really do need to have that.
Yeah.
Well, thank you for joining us for the first half of our show. By now, almost everyone knows of someone who has died this way. So we must remember that these deaths are preventable. Each one of us has the power to make a difference. To all parents, we understand these conversations can be challenging, but don't fool yourself into thinking, not my kid. And to everyone, talk to the people you love. Your words and support can be life-changing. It may be the most crucial discussion you'll ever have with them. One pill will kill. So I'd like to play a special holiday song that's very meaningful. It's about bringing people together and peace, peace and love. So here is Stevie Wonder's Someday at Christmas. We will be right back with our special guest, DEA Special Agent in Charge, Frank Tarentino. You are listening to WUSB Stony Brook 90.1 and 107.3
Someday
FM. We'll be
right back. Christmas, men won't be boys, playing with bombs like kids play with toys. One warm December, our hearts will see a world where men are free. Someday at Christmas, there'll be no wars. When we have learned what Christmas is for, when we have found what life's really worth, there'll be peace on earth. Someday all our dreams will come to be. Someday in a world where men are free. Maybe not in time for you and me, but someday. Time. Someday at Christmas we'll see a land with no hungry children, no empty hand. One happy morning people will share a world where people care. Oh, someday at Christmas there'll be no tears when all men are equal and no man has fears. One shiny moment, one prayer away from our world today.
Welcome back, everyone, to Play It Forward. I'm Allison, and you are listening to WUSB Stony Brook. I'm excited to have New York DEA Special Agent in Charge, Frank Tarentino, with us in the studio today. Welcome back, Frank. Welcome back, everybody. Let's pick up where we left off. So, at the summit in November, you spoke about the challenges of prosecuting on state versus federal level. What do you make of that?
So, when we talk about an overdose or a poisoning investigation, we have to first understand that this is much like a homicide investigation or a murder investigation. So on the federal side, what we look at is we have to initially show either sale, possession, or distribution. And once we can show sale, distribution or possession, then all we have to show is that there was a death that resulted from that. So that's where the death resulting charge comes from. Death by dealer. That's a lot easier than in the state system. So in the state, when there's a homicide or a murder, right, then there's mens rea that's involved. So then we have to talk about, you know, intent, recklessness, or negligence. And so that is a much more difficult charge to prove in the state. And so it, although carries a significant penalty, possibly 25 years to life, we're talking about just a more cumbersome, more difficult procedure and avenue for the prosecutor and the investigative team. So we, as federal agents, will oftentimes try to take our cases through the Southern District of New York and then in the Eastern District of New York here in the New York City metropolitan area, and then, of course, in the Northern and Western Districts of New York, and then all the Southern Districts, or I'm sorry, all the U.S. Attorney's Offices across the United States. We bring these federal cases because, again, it's about establishing sale, possession, or distribution, and then that there's a death that resulted from that. And again, that's a little bit easier to prove.
Wow.
It does not sound easy. All no, that sounds just so complicated.
It does, actually.
Yeah, it's incredible. We wanted to talk a little bit about the border without getting political. I think that it's a nonpartisan issue, and I think that a lot of, as you've spoken to, a lot of the fentanyl coming over is coming from Mexico. So can you touch a little bit about that?
So the vast majority of fentanyl powder and pills that's coming into the United States is coming from Mexico. And again, just to go back so that our listeners understand how this works, the precursor chemicals that are flowing into Mexico originate in China, sometimes in India, but predominantly China. They flow into Mexico, and in these super labs in Mexico, it gets synthesized into fentanyl powder and pills, and then also methamphetamine, and then the methamphetamine and the fentanyl is flowing into the United States by all means necessary. By land, sea, air, underground tunnels, you name it, backpacks, in computer parts, in machinery, in vehicles.
People, I was reading.
Body
yeah,
carriers.
Everything, yep.
So the cartels are really only limited by their imagination and by the amount of precursor chemicals they can get their hands on. So when we talk about the cost effectiveness of this new business that they're in, it's about, we're talking about pennies in terms of how much they can produce. That's how cheap these precursor chemicals are. So when they make these fentanyl pills in Mexico, it's about 7 cents a pill in Mexico.
Oh, my God.
That pill will sell here in the United States for anywhere between $10 up to $30 or $50.
Yeah. Wow.
So the amount of money that they're making is tremendous. And again, it's a business.
Yeah,
right?
Yeah.
And again, we call it the criminal version of Amazon. They have the distribution hubs. They have the networks. They have the transportation units and facilities. This is what they do. This is their business. And so when we talk about the border, what we're focused on is the cartels, Sinaloa and CGNG, that are operating in Mexico. And we're looking at their organizations to take out them from all the way from their manufacturing to the money that's repatriated back to Mexico and mm-hmm. to China. So it's taking out the entire supply chain of the illicit trade. And the border is really where we're seizing the vast majority of these fentanyl powders and pills. But I will say this, that the New York division is the hub, because New York City is the hub of what the Northeast needs in terms of supply and consumption. And when we talk about New York City, we have to also think about the Bronx.
Mm-hmm.
The Bronx is ground zero right now for these distribution networks to push their fentanyl powder and pills into New York City, but also throughout the Northeast. And we've had a number of successful investigations that have proven that recently. But
can
it all
you talk about any of those? I mean, we were just kind of talking off the air about all the everything that's happening in the Bronx, really, and
yeah,
you know, it's kind of a.
So we have a lot of ongoing investigations that we obviously cannot mm-hmm. talk about, but some of the more notable investigations that were in the media, we can go back to, unfortunately, the Danino Nino daycare center, and you know, unfortunately, Nicholas Dominici that died of a poisoning of fentanyl.
1-year-old,
completely unacceptable. As a parent, as a law enforcement professional, this is what we're trying to prevent every day.
And that was a large quantity there as well, right?
There was a large quantity of fentanyl powder and pills in that in the open,
right,
in that daycare center, but then also in clandestinely secreted in traps, mm-hmm, inside of the daycare. So clearly a stash house for fentanyl powder and pills.
And a front, right?
Correct. Right. And we have to remember, too, these drug trafficking organizations do want to operate clandestinely in our areas, in our cities, in our communities. And that's why we saw another incident in the Bronx where we saw fentanyl powder and pills being sold out of a pizzeria. And again, people are shocked by this, and we should be. But I think this is what's happening across our state and across the country right now. Fentanyl is in every state. The cartel is in every state. The cartel is in 50 countries around the world. Fentanyl powder and pills are flowing in record rates, and it's causing tremendous harm. And the DEA and our state and local federal partners are working tirelessly to stop that harm. But it's going to be a continuous effort, and it's going to need a sort of whole of government approach to make a difference. And this is the work that we're doing.
And our community, too. We were talking about, I think every person has to take a responsibility to this. Every American.
Yes.
You care about our country and the people that live here, and the fact that the age of the number one cause of death, 18 to 45, is this. I think it's time that everybody wakes up.
We can all do better. Yeah,
takes action.
Everybody take a stand. Yeah.
Be aware.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, I'd like to, for a second, if I could, just go back to our conversation about the families, and I really am excited about what you're doing here out in Long Island with your family summit. I think it's really important. What I would say is that we learned just as much from the families as I hope they learned from us, and that was the approach that we took. We really wanted to understand this problem from their eyes. And we wanted to understand how it is affecting, you know, the communities in which they live. And I will tell you that because of those conversations, we changed our ideology, our thought process of what we were calling these. We started calling them poisonings because of our conversations with families, because moms and dads were telling us that their kids were poisoned. And the reason that they were poisoned is because they were unsuspectingly taking a drug that they thought was cocaine or heroin, or that they thought was they were taking a legitimate oxycodone or a Adderall pill, and it was actually laced with fentanyl. So because of those conversations, we started shifting our vernacular, our language about what we were calling these things. And now we're calling them poisonings because that's exactly what they are.
It's not an overdose.
It's not an overdose. People are unsuspectingly dying because they have no idea what they're ingesting. Yeah. And so I think that's really important. And, you know, I say that, and, you know, it's not something that I created, but I think it's really profound. And that is, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And we wanted the families to know that we care, that we're listening. And listening to them has changed how we approach our job every day.
And that's beautiful. Say that line again. I think people need to hear that.
Yeah,
that's really,
I remember when you said that.
I mean, very simply, people don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. And when you care about something, and when people genuinely feel that you're interested in them as a human being, and they want to see you succeed, then they will listen. And as a parent, I think we all can identify with that.
Yeah.
When our children know that we truly love them and we care about them, then they may understand why we put these parameters in place, these guardrails in place. Mm. So really it's about making sure that people understand how much you care about them and about their health and welfare.
Well, and I remember, I think it was Carol Trottier that I first heard use the poisoning thing. And that was like such a gut punch to me once she explained it. And I was like, you know, that is just the most heartbreaking thing ever, and that really is, you know, really is a poisoning, you know.
Yeah,
it is. But it is, you bring up a good point, how important our language is in bringing this up, and the numbers, right,
and how it's constantly evolving too. I mean, the language of this is, I feel, changes a lot from substance use disorder to, you know, just everything, the way we talk about it, the stigma of it,
right? Yeah, exactly.
I would also say that you know, we talk about trust. And you know, building trust is really important in any profession, any relationship, certainly in law enforcement. But I would also say trust is something that is lacking in the criminal world, right? In drug trafficking, what I would tell people who are substance use dependent, do not trust your dealer. Do not trust the person that is giving you this poison, or that is giving you what you believe to be cocaine or heroin or methamphetamine. Do not trust that they care about you. they really only care about your money. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And they're driven by greed and power. And so what we tell people is don't trust your dealer, because your dealer is going to kill you.
The kid that I mentioned before, I mean, the person that he bought it from, friend of his for years, was in recovery with him. Like, and they don't care. They don't care.
And, you know, Kurt, that's a great point. And I'm sorry, Allison. The question we get all the time, which is shocking, is why would they want to kill their customer? People ask us that all the time. Young people and I would say wiser people ask us this question all the time. And the truth is what you said. They do not care.
No.
They only care about the money that's going to go into
their
pocket.
Because it's so much money.
Yeah.
And but it is a good question. Because if they don't kill them, then they have a customer for life.
That's right.
And when it's only costing you 7 cents to make, and it's like, terrible.
It is so important. I like that you brought up the families, and I found that last part of the summit to be amazing as well, listening to every person that got up to ask you guys a question really had so much. I can see why it would help you guys.
Yeah.
We really want to bring that here to Suffolk County. I think it's really important. And thank you again for what you're doing.
Where are we on to next here?
Well, we could talk about numbers. I think we could sort of recap for the audience to understand just how widespread this problem is. We talk about, when we talk about 110,757 Americans, that number is a big number, but people don't always, I think, understand or associate how big that number is. But if we break it down a little bit, I think it's a more impactful number. When we talk about one person's dying every 5 minutes, that 303 Americans will die every single day in the United States, that 12 people will die in the 1 hour that you and I are having this conversation, that's impactful. And that should resonate with every American, that this is killing people, Americans, at record rates. It's killing more Americans than COVID. It's killing more Americans than gun violence. It's killing more Americans than motor vehicle accidents. This is what's killing Americans right now. And as I said earlier, it's the leading cause of death between ages 18 to 45. So this is what people should be focused on right now.
And they're not talking about it enough.
They're not. I would agree.
I didn't mean to interrupt you.
Yeah, no, I would agree. You're 100% right.
I find it so frustrating. Occasionally, I'll see an ad, a PSA, about fentanyl, but like very rarely.
Yeah.
And or on the train, right? I'll see occasional bill, but I don't see it the way when we had COVID. Every day we were told how many people died. Every single day it was
underneath.
On the front page every day.
Yeah.
This is how many people died. It should be the same thing.
Mm-hmm.
There needs to be that much more awareness.
Yeah.
And I keep thinking about what Megan O'Donnell said, and you brought it up in the beginning of the show. I think people have become desensitized to it to some extent. Maybe they need more, like you said, it was a gut punch when I heard about it was a poisoning, and that really jarred me.
Yeah.
What else, what more is it going to take? Like, what will it take?
Yeah, I think that the tragedy that unfolded in the Bronx with the young toddler, Nicholas, 1 year old, had not even a chance to live a long, productive life like we would want from all of our young people. And so that tragedy did raise, I think, the awareness in New York City and across the United States, but we cannot let up. We cannot lose the momentum that tragedy brought to that city and to that community. We have to continuously remind the families in the community that this can impact anyone, anytime, and we can't let up. We can't forget that this is a fight.
Yeah.
Every single day, it is a fight to save lives. It is a fight to remove this poison from the street. And this is why it's so great right now, during this time of year, during Christmas, during the new year, to reconnect with our family in so many ways. Mm. Obviously, if our young people have been away at college, it's great to have them home. If people are just visiting, it's great to have them in the house and to celebrate, such a joyous occasion. But again, take this opportunity to have that conversation.
Have them. Yeah.
Because you might not have that if you skip that conversation,
you might not have another
chance.
You
may regret it.
Yeah, absolutely.
Yeah, you definitely. There's no downside to having that conversation. No. And maybe a couple eye rolls,
yeah.
Right? But
and there are local organizations and resources that even provide information to parents. Like FIST is on Long Island. They help parents start the conversation.
Families
how
and
to
supportive
approach
treatment.
The children. Yeah.
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 Yep.
And Claudia. I think it's great that we're going to have a club on Stony Brook campus, and we need more students involved and part
young
of Play
people.
It Forward. Yeah.
Yeah, willing to have those hard conversations.
Yeah. And I'm wondering, do you have any advice for starting the club?
So, Taylor, I think you've done a great job with starting the conversation and having the desire and certainly the awareness to start a club as important as this one. And I would just tell you that what you should really concentrate on is, you know, getting your mission statement out there and making sure that people understand the purpose behind the club, which is really saving lives, just like we are.
Mm-hmm.
And I think people will rally to that cause. And I would join that club. Sign me up.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. But, you know, it's funny. I think, Allison, you said earlier how important it is that our children understand that we care about them. And when we have these conversations with them, it's because we care. And I would say that during this time of year, as we go through the holidays and we are excited about might be under the tree or what might be in the stocking, I think the greatest gift that we can give our loved ones is this gift of conversation.
Mm.
And that is what shows the love and the care that is going to save lives.
Absolutely. Let's make this a mass effort.
Yes.
That's right.
Well
yeah.
said. Yeah. We were talking about different cases, and we were talking about young people. I remember recently in the news, I don't remember how many, but in Virginia, there were several kids mm-hmm. that took what they thought were gummies, right?
Yeah.
About five kids, and it was fentanyl. And they were elementary school kids.
Oh, my God.
Yeah.
That's sad.
Yeah. You know, I haven't really read enough about that investigation to know the specifics. What I would say is that this is our message to the American people, and that is that anything that you get on the street or on social media today, any illicit drug that you're buying is potentially laced with fentanyl, and it's lethal. And so I would just say that, again, go back to do not trust your dealer. And I would just encourage, you know, the parents, educators, and caregivers to know that these cartels are specifically, deliberately, treacherously targeting young people by advertising their poison in different shapes and forms and colors. That's intentional.
Wow. Hang in there, kids.
Yes. Listen to your parents, and parents talk, and caregivers talk to your kids.
Really quick, we didn't talk about this at all, but marijuana, medical cannabis, and fentanyl, I've heard some things about it popping up and stuff, and I think that with the recent recreational and legalization in New York, it's something that is worth talking about. You know,
absolutely.
Everybody just goes to their weed guy, and what if your weed guy is...
Are you seeing it?
Yeah.
Opening the bags.
Right.
So, Kurt, what we have seen is a few instances of fentanyl residue in packaging in which marijuana was seized. What we have not yet proven through laboratory testing is actually marijuana laced with fentanyl.
Okay.
I would say that anything is possible in today's synthetic world that we live in. The synthetic drug world is ever increasing and evolving. And so we can talk about a number of different synthetic drugs today, whether it's xylazine or nitazenes. These are all man-made drugs. And so anything is possible when we talk about other drugs being mixed with fentanyl.
Just something to be aware of, anybody out there, you know?
Well, Mark Murray brought up something important, or no, it was the other person that presented that marijuana stays in your system for much longer.
Mm-hmm.
And so from an autopsy perspective, to figure out if that person was poisoned by fentanyl through marijuana, you're not going to be able to see it in a point of view from an autopsy, I suppose.
Well, I would say that, you know, the medical examiner's office in New York City, Dr. Jason Graham, who has become an incredible collaborative partner in this fight, they do incredible work, and their toxicology screens are really reliable, highly reliable, and very methodical. A lot of testing, a lot of data. We haven't seen instances of this, this masking of fentanyl. What I would tell the people listening today is that, you know, there are some things that people can do to educate themselves and to possibly prevent these overdoses and poisonings. And, you know, one of those things is going to our site, obviously, and then also just being mindful of the, you know, what's available in your immediate area mm-hmm. to bring somebody out of an overdose state. You know, there's 911, of course, but there's also, of course, you know, narcan. Or nalaxone, mm-hmm. Which our agents carry. All of our agents are provided the nalaxone or the Narcan, and they have that first and foremost for themselves in the event that they become exposed. In contact or, yeah, they become exposed to fentanyl powder. And or in the event that they arrive on a scene and somebody's in an overdose state, they can deploy it. And you know, again, this is something that we would just tell people that, you know, Narcan, it should be used because you never know if it's going to be fentanyl or not. Mm-hmm. But Narcan's not going to hurt anybody.
Right.
Better safe than sorry, yeah.
Yeah.
And so, I think with the ever-changing landscape, it's just important to remember to keep having these conversations, stay vigilant, and talk to one another.
Yeah. So this goes pretty quick, but... Before we wrap up,
yeah.
Maybe in a few words or so,
yeah.
What key message or takeaway would you want to leave our listeners with?
I think we could just go back and recapture what we said earlier, and that is have those difficult conversations yeah. and take the time to understand what your children are involved in and listen and get curious about the conversations that they're having. So it's about reconnecting and having genuine, honest conversations with our loved ones. And I think it's also just being mindful that one pill can kill,
yeah.
that
yeah.
poison is out there. And we should be vigilant, as you said, and we should be mindful that if it's not coming from a professional, trusted doctor and dispensed by a licensed pharmacist, we should not be yeah. taking it.
Directly. Yeah. And Narcan is free.
Yes.
That's right.
Thank you so much, DEA Special Agent in Charge Frank Tarentino, for being our guest today and for your outstanding and honorable service. And thank you, Aaron. I sincerely thank everyone who supports our cause and understands how important it is to look out for each other and to empathize with anyone you know dealing with addiction. Let's continue to spread awareness about the dangers of illicit fentanyl and promote harm reduction tools like Narcan and fentanyl test strips. So reach out to us on via Instagram, sbu.playitforward, for more recommendations.
If you are struggling with mental health or substance use, you are not alone. SAMHSA offers services and resources for substance use disorder. 1-800-662-HELP for support. SAMHSA also has a 24/7 info service at 1-800-487-4889. For additional help, you can visit Hope House Ministries online at hhm.org or call 631-928-2377. LICAD, Long Island Council on Alcoholism and Drug Dependence, offers support and guidance at 631-979-1700, and you can find more information at LICAD.org. I also want to include one more, a website that a good friend of mine made, and it's called beyondtheopioidcrisis.com, and it has a lot of info about substance use disorder, the opioid epidemic, and the effects that it had on us during COVID. So wow. Please check that out as well.
Awesome.
And LICAD also gives out free Narcan kits on Long Island.
Mm.
Also, CPO, Center for Prevention and Outreach, is a department at Stony Brook. If you are a local Stony Brook community member, check out Stony Brook CPO's SB Engaged page. It's super user-friendly and easy to check out their resources and trainings. On behalf of Play It Forward, thank you all for listening. We invite you to join us on Instagram and YouTube, and we hope to hear from you. Our Instagram is sbu.playitforward, and our YouTube is the Play It Forward Project. We hope that our message reaches somebody. So for now and always,
keep playing it forward.
Aw, thank you, Taylor and Kurt. And this is Allison of the Play It Forward Project, and I hope you tune in to our next show on January 5th next year at 1 p.m. This is our last show for the year.
Ooh, 2023, wrapping it up.
Yeah, wrapping up 2023 and having Frank on twice
yeah.
this year. Thank you so much.
My pleasure.
You got a nice jacket.
For your service and your time with us today. And Thank you, Tyrone and WUSB, and of course, my wonderful co-hosts, Kurt and Taylor.
Thank you, Allison.
I wish everyone out there a wonderful, happy, healthy holiday, a happy new year. Have those conversations with your loved ones. Don't think it can't be your kid. Have the conversation. So you are listening to WUSB Stony Brook 90.1 and 107.3. Frank picked out a special song, Do They Know It's Christmas Time? I think it's from the 80s, but a great one. Be well, everyone. Happy holidays. Merry Christmas. Happy Hanukkah. Happy New Year.
It's Christmas. Happy holidays.
Please look out for one another.
We let in light and we banish it.
Yeah, I remember when
at Christmas time.